Okay, so welcome everybody to our first re-lecture on scientific Python. So as promised, today we're going to talk about basic programming in Python. So we said that we assume that you already all know the basics of programming, and today we're going, and like also on Thursday, we're going to show you how to do the usual stuff you know from other programming languages in Python. So we'll talk about the simple data types in Python, basic operators that you can use, collections of data in control flow, and later also about functions and classes. If you want to follow along, which you should do basically, you should go to scientificprogramming.com/lecture, so our repository. You can just Google for the link. So you see it here, right? It's github.com/scientificprogrammingos/lectures. If you Google for that, I think you should find it. And then again, you can go to Launch Binder here and click here, and then you should be directed to the same JupyterHub environment that I have here. So you should see something like this, and then here, like on the side browser, you can go to Week 2 Basic Programming with Python and the lecture.ipynb file. Because we also have some small exercises in between, and so you can do them there. Maybe before I start, just a general question. So who is still facing issues with installing Python on their machine? No one? Well, that's great. So yeah, we're again sorry for the problems we had with Windows. That used to work. This year it doesn't, but anyway, now problems seem to be fixed. So let's get started. So in every programming language, we have something which are basic or atomic types. So these are usual things like integers, floating point numbers, strings, and booleans. And you somehow have to create them, and you usually use literals to create them. So a literal means that you just explicitly write down what you want to have, and you don't use any, so to say, expression of your programming language. So start very simply. We are here in JupyterLab. Again, just the blue thing here on the side tells you at which cell you are. You can use the arrow keys to navigate up and down, and then you can press Shift Enter to execute that cell, and you will see the result of that cell below. So in this case, we see, okay, we entered a 2, and we in fact got a 2 back. So nothing very surprising here. So this would create an integer. To create floating point numbers, we have to write a number dot something else, and we get this floating point number. And to get a boolean, we write the expression true that is capitalized in the beginning. So counterpart to that would be to write false, and we would get the value of false. So now what's very important in Python also to give you, so when learning a new programming language, it's always important to have a good mental model of what the programming language is doing internally. So, and I try to talk a bit about the what happens in the background while I show you how to do the things. And the very important thing is that all things in Python are objects. So really a credo that you can have is everything is an object in Python. So what this means is just that really everything that you have in your in the runtime of your program is somehow an instance of object and has some guarantees that you can expect from it. So we see this expression here. We have is instance 2 and then object. So this basically asks the question, is 2 an instance of object? So this is similar to in Java where you have instance of. And we can ask this for all the three types that we just created, and we see, okay, all of them are objects. So an object means that it has data and it has behavior, and every object has some data and it also has methods associated with it that contain the behavior. So for example, we can use the dir function here and call this on the boolean object true, and we get all the methods that are and attributes that are defined on this object. So in contrast to Java, where you have like primitive data types, for example, you have integers or floats that don't really have any methods and are really just plain data, you don't have this in Python. So everything is an object. Everything has methods associated with it that somehow defines the behavior of that data. So far about this. Then another basic type in Python is a string. To create a string, you use string literals. That means that you write the string and you put quotation marks around it. So doing this, we get the string. So also in Python, you don't have a character class. So maybe you know from Java that you have a char class that just represents a single character. You don't have this distinction in Python. You just have strings. So even a single character would still be a string. To create strings or string literals, you can either use double or single quotation marks. That's equally valid. I would recommend using double quotation marks. However, if you want to embed the other type of quotation mark inside the string, you can just do that. So here we use the double quotation marks to define the string, but inside the string we use single quotation marks, and then inside our string we will have the other type of quotation marks. And then another way to create string is so-called multi-line strings. This is when you put triple quotes around your string. And then what you can do is you can embed the other two types of quotation marks inside your string, and you can also embed new lines. So we have a line break here, and when we get the result of this, we see that these new line characters that we have in our string here are now also part of the string. We see this even more explicitly if we don't print the string, but we just basically get the output of that string, and we see that now we have here these backslash n characters, which represent line breaks, and they were inserted just by having line breaks in our original string. So that's sometimes handy. Okay, so next topic is the print function. So the print function is a convenience function to print things to the console. In Jupyter, you don't really need it so often because you can just put the last object that you're interested in at the bottom of the cell and then execute the cell and then see the output directly. But to get multiple outputs, you can use a print function. So here we are printing an integer, a floating point number, and a boolean. And we get the string representation of all those objects, and they are printed as the output of the cell. So what you can imagine what happens internally is that the objects that you pass to print are first transformed into a string. So the output of these two calls should be equivalent. So whether you call print on an object or you call string, or you call print on string of that object, it should always be the same. So yeah. So this is like the basic data types that you have in Python. However, we can't really do anything much yet because we have no way to get a handle on these objects. We can create this object, but we can print them at the output of the cell, but we don't have any way to manipulate them because they vanish in the minute where we execute the cell. So for this purpose, every programming language has variables. So variables are defined in Python very simply. You just write a name of the variable that you want to create, you write equals, and then you write the object that you want to assign to this variable. So here we assign 2 to A, the string hello to B, and true to C, and then we can print all of those referring only to the variables. So now this is a good moment to talk about a very important aspect of Python in contrast to other programming languages like Java that you might know. So what happens in Java when you would write an expression int a equals 1 or something. So, and have a semicolon. So what happens, what you maybe were told in your Info A lecture, is that this expression here creates, so to say, a box in memory where the integer 1 is stored. So what happens here is, okay, the compiler looks, okay, I have an integer a, so I have to somehow reserve the necessary bytes to represent this an integer, so this would be 4 bytes, I guess. And then we would say, okay, we want to have a 1 inside this box, so we write the bit pattern that represents the 1 inside this memory space. So in Java, it's equally possible to write something like this, right? You can say integer a, and then on the next line, you have a equals 1, and this would result in the same happening. So first, the space in memory is reserved, then the bit pattern that represents the 1 is written in there. So in Python, something very different happens, in fact. So this is Java. So now we have Python. So when we write the expression a equals 1, what happens is that the interpreter that executes the Python code will look at the statement and say, okay, here I have a 1. So I need to create an object inside memory that represents a 1. So again, we'll have this space in memory that is allocated and that is directly filled with a bit pattern that somehow represents a 1. And then in the second step, the interpreter will see, okay, and I also want to assign this object to the variable a. So we can think of it like having a second space here in Python, where we have our objects, and here we have our variables. And so what will happen, okay, we say we create a variable called a, and then we will assign this variable to the space in memory that represents the 1. So this is really the distinction that we have here in Python. So creating a variable does not allocate space in memory, but only objects take care themselves of creating the necessary space for them, and then we only link them to the variables. So variables are really just names for objects. They don't internally contain any kind of data. So given that you can, this is also great that this is not hidden here, you can reason about the following statement. So this is now our first interactive exercise. So, but we can also do this together right now. Let's maybe go here. So we have the statements a equals 1, then b equals a, and then a equals 2. So, and now the question is, what will happen inside the interpreter, and what will be the result in the end of b? So any ideas on what will be the value of b after executing these three lines? Yes. Yes, exactly. So why would that be the case? Yeah, exactly. So what happens here, right, we create, so I just now, instead of writing this bit pattern, I just like write 1 here to represent the object. So this creates an object 1 and creates a variable a and points a to 1. Then in this second line, it creates a variable called b and also points this to the object 1. And then this line first creates an object 2 and then basically destroys this connection and connects a to 2, but still the connection of b to the object 1 is not changed by this. So does this make sense, or does this not make sense to anyone? That's great, because then you really understood a very basic property of Python. So just to verify this, we execute this, okay, b is the value of 1. Okay, while talking about variables, it's also a good moment to start talking about naming conventions. So as we mentioned in the first lecture, so just writing code that executes correctly is not most of the work, but a lot of work also goes into making the programs understandable to others. So and for doing this, conventions really help. So, or style guide convention. So PEP8, what does it mean? It stands for Python Enhancement Proposal number 8. So by now we probably have a few thousand Python Enhancement Proposals, so it's one of the early ones, but it's a way how the Python community structures changes to the Python language. So if you want to make a change to the Python language, you can make a PEP and you describe what a kind of change you want to make, and then the community can discuss whether that makes sense or not. So on PEP8 was a proposal for proposing a style guide for writing Python code. And it's very good, like if you write Python code, that you stick to the style guide, because everyone uses the style guide and then everybody can directly understand your code, and also you can understand the code of others. And here we just have the naming conventions for variable that PEP8 recommends. So it's actually very easy. So there are different possible naming conventions for variable names, but most of the time it's either snake case, so something like this, snake case because you have a underscore here and it maybe looks like a snake, and then you have camel case where you have like capital letters, so the different words somehow put together using different capitals. So in Python you would use snake case for everything except for class names and exceptions, which are also classes actually, and then for global constants, which you shouldn't have most of the time, you would use just capitals but separate the words with underscores. Yeah, so we will stick to this convention. You should also stick to this convention, and if you are ever unsure how to structure a specific part of your Python code, you should just have a look at PEP8. Okay, so next topic will be typing. So a few words about the Python type system. So Python is dynamically but strongly typed. So dynamically typed means it doesn't have like any strong enforcements of like what kind of types objects should take, and it also allows, so to say, I mean, you can say it allows statements like this, where you can have, okay, before I explain this, let me first introduce a type function. So if you have type of some object, it will give you the type of this object very intuitively. So the type of true is bool, because it's a boolean. So because Python is dynamically typed, you can do statements like this, right? You can assign 1 to A, then the type of A will be an integer, and then you can assign a string to A, and now the type of A will be a string. So this is something that you couldn't do in Java, right? You would always declare the type of your variable first, and then you can only assign things of the same type to this variable. You cannot really change them in between. I mean, under the hood, what happens here is also not really that the type of A changes, but just that the object that A points to changes. But still, like, looking at this code, it looks really dynamic, so to say. However, Python is still strongly typed because it does not allow objects, so to say, to change their type. So the type of a string object that lives in this object space here, this will always be a string. This will not really change the interpretation, and will suddenly, so the bit pattern here will not suddenly be interpreted as an integer. And also what you can not do is things like this. So to add a number to a string, it will give a type error, in fact, because there's no sensible way to add a number to a string. What other programming languages often do, they try to convert the two operands to the other type so that you can somehow make a operation that makes sense, but it's actually much safer and saves you a lot of errors if this is not done explicitly, but you just get a type error, and what you can then do, you can explicitly, so to say, convert the object to a string, and then the thing will work and you get an 11 here. Yes.
If we change the type to like string hello, where does the type integer, the number one stay? Is this object deleted afterwards?
Yes, exactly. So that's a very good question. So Python handles memory by itself, and this happens via two mechanisms, and the first most prominent one is just reference counting. So reference counting means that for each object here in the object space, each object will know how many variables point to that object, and it will keep an internal count of the number of references that point to that object. So in this case, where here we first assigned A to 1, it will see, okay, I have one reference, so I should not delete myself. Then it has two references, it still says, okay, I should not delete myself. So then here we assigned A to something else, but the object 1 still has a single reference, so nothing happens. So now if you would go and say assign B to something else, say to 3, then we would create a new object 3, we would point B to 3, but we would also delete this reference, and then the object would know, okay, I don't have a single reference anymore. So it's actually virtually impossible in your program to make any use of this object anymore because you don't have any reference that points to it. So Python just says, okay, I don't have any references, I just delete the object and free the memory again. So this then just goes to Nirvana. Okay, does this answer your question? Okay, good. Okay, so now we have simple objects that we can also assign to variables, but we cannot really do anything with them yet, except ask for some information about them. So obviously Python defines operators. So operators are just a nice piece of syntax to do some, to do some common task, often like in mathematical expressions, and Python has all the standard operators that you would expect. So we can, so here we create a number 2 and a number 3, and then we can add those, we can subtract those, we can multiply those, we can take the power of the one to the next. So this is not to be confounded with like this, because it would be bitwise XOR, that would result in something very different. So so to say, taking the power is just multiplying twice. Then you can divide those, you can also make a floor division. So if you just round down the result of the division to the next integer, and you can also do the modulo of two things. So we see here the results of all those. It should all make sense. And what's interesting also, if you divide two integers, so here we did this, we have type A is int, type B is int, but the type of A divided by C is a float, by A divided by B is a float. So we, if we divide A by B, it will automatically figure out that you cannot represent the result of this division as a as an integer anymore, and it will turn the object into a, or it will return a float that represents what makes more sense for the division. So this is also something that was just introduced in Python 3, but it makes reasoning a lot easier, and you don't have to watch your code so closely. So what you can also do is combine operators with assignments. So this is also very common in a lot of programming languages. So instead of writing A equals A plus 1, you can just write A plus equals 1. And the result, yeah, will be then an increment. And if we execute this multiple times, we will always get one more. Yes?
So you're just saying that if you, if you want to print something, like a text and a variable afterwards, you always need this comma in between.
You mean like here, or?
No, it was above, like
here. Okay, so this is something about the print function. So the print function takes, we will get to this later when we talk about functions, takes a variable number of arguments. So we can just print a single object that is like this, but you can also print like two objects, and you separate those by a comma. And you can print basically any number you want of objects, and all of them will be printed on the same line. So this is just a shortcut for not writing print twice, and also like making, putting the results of print on the same line. Okay. Yeah, so operators are not just defined on numbers, so like strings or like integers or floats, but also on strings, and in fact can be defined on any Python object, and we will see like maybe just next week how this works. But for now, you can just know that you can also add together two strings, and the result of that will be a concatenation. So, yeah. And you can also multiply strings, and this will just repeat the string n times, so the number of times you multiplied it with. And yeah, that's also sometimes handy. What you cannot do is divide a string, because there's no sensible interpretation of dividing a string by a number, and similarly you cannot multiply a string by a float, because you cannot, I mean, you could think about having half a string and concatenating this, but yeah, this is not really helpful, I guess, most of the time. So the string only defines these two operators that you can perform in a meaningful way. Then next you have Boolean operators that you probably also all know very well. So we have, again, numbers 2 and 3, and then we can ask things like, is number A bigger than 3? Is number A bigger or equal to 3? Is it the same? Is it different? So this is equals and unequals, and smaller equals. And we print all the results of those and get the results that we would expect. And, yeah, so interestingly, these writing this is really an expression So this means that it returns a value. So writing a bigger than 3 is false, and we also get the value or the object false returned from this expression. And so this also means that we can assign the result of such expressions to other variables. So we can assign 1 bigger 3 to a, which would be the same as assigning false to a, and we can assign 3 equals 3 to b, which is true, and then we can print those, and then we can also use these conditional operators here to to combine different Boolean values. So we can take the or, the and, and the negation of things, and just execute this for now. So this is here at the top, this is A, this is B, true and false, and then A or B, so true or false is true, true and false is false, and not true is also false. So maybe you know from Java you have these double ampersand and double, like, basically this, can't really write the ampersand in this things, but in Python it's really like, it emphasizes readability, so you just write and, or, and not. And then finally there's the is operator, and the is operator does not, so what the is operator does is it checks for object identity. So we can ask, is A the same as B? And that's not the case. So what this means internally again is that we, maybe I can clean this up a bit while we're here at it. So we have the two objects, 2 and 3. And if we ask, so to say, are those the same or is this the same, it will check, okay, are we looking at the same object? Are the two variables pointing to the same object? So this is not the case. Now if we would make another statement here where we assign the value of 3 to A, what the interpreter might do is look in the object space and say, well, I already have an object 3. So I might as well assign A just to the same object. And then if we ask A is 3, A is B, it would probably return true, because these two variables really point to the same object in the object space. So what this defaults to is also, so each object in Python has its ID that specifies, that's unique to the object, and what is basically does it compares or checks for equality of the of those IDs. However, be careful, so checking for identity is not the same as checking for equality, so two objects could represent the same thing. So in the last statement, when we created a new object 3, what the interpreter might also do is just say, okay, I don't really want to look that I already have an object 3, I just create a new object 3 and assign A to this new object, and then A is B would be false. So don't rely on this. However, A equals B would still be true, because a 3 is still a 3 regardless of where it lives in the memory. So identity does not, equality does not imply identity. However, also identity does not always imply, it doesn't actually not always imply equality, though it should imply equality most of the time. However, we'll get back to this later. For now, I just should switch to some other screen where I can actually hide the solutions. So, but what you can do, because you shouldn't see the solutions, is we have this small exercise here, and you should use the Python operators that you just learned to answer the question whether this expression is true or false. Yeah, and you have, hopefully you can all execute the code in JupyterLab, and you have like 3 minutes or so to do this, and then you can tell me whether it's true or false. Hast du das GitHub Repository oder bist du auf Binder? Dann würde ich auf Binder gehen. Also, so if you are facing the problem that you have a different version of the slides that I show here, it might be because you locally cloned our lectures repository and then you did not pull before the lecture started, because lectures, yeah, we will update them before we give them, and what's really best is just go to the GitHub page and launch Binder, and then you have a environment where you can do the computation and you have the most recent version. And otherwise, it's also probably totally valid to just pull the newest version. But also, like, the plugins don't necessarily work on your version. So, for example, here on Binder, you should see something like this where it says reveal solution, and the solution by default is not revealed. So if you see something else or don't see anything about solutions, then it's better to go to Binder. Who was already able to compute the result of this expression? Not so many yet, so let's give it one more minute and then... Okay, so what is the result? Is it true or false here? Yes?
True.
Yeah, let's check. This should, in fact, so is there, wait. Yeah, exactly. So this expression translated to Python code using the mathematical operators would look something like this. So you have like the addition here, you have the power of 3 here, and then you can use bigger and then modulo divided by 3. So yeah, so much about this. So
sorry?
Yes?
How would I know that the interpreter has equal priority for modulo and division?
Yeah, this is something that you really like have to know, because yeah, there are different, forget how you call this, but like which operators are preferred or like combined first. However, what I usually tend to do if I'm not sure is just like put square brackets around here, and then you can be really sure that this is executed before the division by 3.
But
yeah, it seems so, that modulo at least like does not, at least like division does not bind stronger than modulo. So.
Or
yeah, okay, I have same precedence. Yeah. So because they have same precedence, like this just executes from left to right, but yeah. This is something that like you can learn for every operator and keep a table which has which precedence, but in cases of doubt just put parentheses about around what you want to execute first. Okay. So next up, we are getting into functions. This is still like big enough to read. Okay, so we already saw some functions, and like functions are maybe something that you know very well from other programming languages. So for example, like in general, functions are defined by some function name, and then when you want to call the functions, you put parentheses behind that function and pass all the arguments to that function. So in our case, print is a function, type is also a function, the len of something is a function, and rounding something is a function. So you see here we can print the type of is an int, the len of the string hello is 5, and yeah, rounding 3.3 gives us 3. So here's some very useful tip for getting around in the Python world, especially if you are in a Jupyter notebook, to get help, because like there are bazillion functions and you cannot know their signatures and what they do by heart. And so what you can do is get help on those functions and put a question mark after the function, execute the cell, and then you will be given some help on how to use this function. So you first get the signature, that means like how are the arguments called that you have to pass to the function. So in this case for round, we know that we have to pass a number and that we can also pass an argument in digits, which is by default assigned to the value none. So if we do not pass, like here, we only pass the single argument to round, that is okay because the second argument has a default value. Then you also get something called a doc string, and the doc string just is there for documenting what the function does. And it gives a textual description of what the function does, and then you can also get the type of the function, which is by default built-in function or method. And so we see here that we can also pass the second argument, so we could pass the n digits number, and we will only get like 2 significant digits when we round. I think here it's a value of pi. And not sure if we do this later, but what you can also do if you want to make your code more readable, you can write the name of the argument equals the value in the function call. So by doing this, you don't, like when someone else reads your code, they don't have to go and inspect the doc string manually. They will directly see, okay, the value of 2 means n digits, which maybe is like more helpful than just seeing 2 if you don't know the function. So this is good practice to make your code more readable. In fact, for Java, for example, the IDEs, they are doing this now implicitly, so they write the names of the arguments in front of, but they don't put it in the code, so you only see it in the IDE. So in Python, you can totally valid Python to write this directly. So another important point about Python is that functions are first-class objects. So this means, more or less, that a function is like the object 2 and 3 is just something that lives in the object space, and it's just like a blob of code that you can treat as any other object. So this means that you can assign a function to a variable. So here we have the variable a function, and we assign the print function to it. And then we can subsequently call the variable like we called the print function before. And yeah, executing this, we will end up with print this variable, we will see it's a built-in function print, and if we ask for the type of that variable, it's again a built-in class or method. So, and doing this enables very powerful patterns where you can abstract over functions and have functions that take other functions as arguments. So for example, here we have, okay, we we didn't get to the function syntax yet, so let's do it here. So to define a new function yourself, you write def in front, and then the name of the function that you want to define, and then in brackets the arguments that the function has. Then a colon, and then here with some indent there's the function body, so the code that gets executed when you call that function. Here we can also note a very important property of Python, so Python doesn't use curly braces to structure blocks of code. So this is what many other programming languages do, and what often gives you a headache, because you try to match that last parentheses that is somehow missing, and you don't cannot figure out where it actually started and where it ended. In Python you don't have this problem, because it's all just indented by four spaces, and then all the stuff here is basically part of this function block. So and what we do here, we have two arguments, a number and a what, and what we do inside the function is we print the result of calling what on the number. So this means that we can now pass a number and the function round, and we will get the result of, and we will be printed the result of applying round to the number -3.15. And we can also pass a different function to this function again, and yeah, and we will also just see this thing, and then we can also just we can really pass any kind of function. So okay, floor is actually not defined by default. Okay, then let's not do this right now. anyway, so but this just shows you that function is really not any different from any other kind of object. So really, you can think of a function just instead of an object. You can think of like some block of code that somehow is here in the object space, and where you can assign any kind of variable to it that you can do with any other kind of object. Okay. So a kind of counterpart to functions are methods. So when you have a function, you pass the data to it and get a result. If you have a method, you start with the data and then you call some behavior on that data. So instead of writing function of arguments, you write the object dot method and then with the arguments. So it's also some kind of function, but it is defined only on certain objects, and by default it takes the object it is called on implicitly as the first argument. So and this is just this part of this object-oriented style of coding, where you have behavior directly defined on the data, and you can, by doing this, you can really nicely structure your behavior that you defined in your program. So here, okay, we already know that string actually is an object as well, and these string objects here assigned to the variable a have a lot of methods. So we can capitalize a string, we can replace things inside a string with other stuff, we can make it lowercase, uppercase, or ask whether it's numeric or alphanumeric or whatever. So printing all this, just here we will see capitalize actually just capitalizes the first letter here, which initially was lowercase. This replaces all occurrences of letter L with the letter capital X. And here this makes a string all lowercase, this makes a string all uppercase. And so really the idea is here that doing this, it really makes it easy to find the behavior that is can operate in a sensible way on your data. So if you have the variable a that you know is a string, you can put a dot here and then press tab, and you will see all the methods that are defined on this object. And often when you like work with some kind of new library, the first thing I do is like create an object and then scroll to this this methods here that are defined on the objects to get an idea of what I can do with those objects. So here we see that there's actually a lot that we can do with strings, but again, this is often better than like having all these all these behaviors defined in the global space. So if you would have all the functions that are defined on strings and on integers and on floating point numbers just here, and instead of a.capitalized, we would have to write capitalized.a or capitalize of a, we would not be able to search through the behavior defined on a string in a sensible way. We would always have all the behavior right there. Yeah, okay, so here again, dir is the function you can use to get all the methods that are defined on an object. So here's just the empty string, and it defines all these methods here by default. And again, if you want to get help on a method, you can also, I mean, you can, what you can do is just again do this tab thing, or you can call the help function here. So maybe again, if I have this A, and I do this, and I do put the caret after the opening parentheses, and then press shift tab, I get help on this function. But I can also call the help function directly and get some help on this. So and again, what does not work is that you call a method that is not defined on this type. So here b was an integer. Let's again see this. Is 5, and we cannot call b.capitalize because there's no sensible definition of capitalizing an integer. Yes. Okay, so any questions regarding functions or methods right now? If not, then we can get to the next part, which is about collections. So until now, we were only dealing with, so to say, atomic or basic types, where each object really was an object on its own. So often, instead of having just single objects, you want to have, you want to do things on multiple objects, and this is where collections come into play. So really, the collections types, or the, even the ones defined in the standard library, are very, very flexible types that like allow you to do really a lot of powerful things, and are really one of the maybe the best things about Python. So the most, or maybe the most flexible, or like most used collection type is a list. So a list is defined by, again, as a list literal, to by using square brackets and then putting the objects that you want to put in this list, and then separate those by commas. So when we assign this to a variable and print it, we see, okay, this is the string representation of a list that looks basically how we defined it here, and we will get the class of list. Lists are very flexible because, unlike maybe Java arrays that have that demand that all of the objects inside it are of a certain type, you can put any type of object inside there. So here we have, we create a temporary variable called object, which is really just an object. Then we have strings, we have integers, we have floats here, booleans, and a list itself, and we can put all of those in a bigger list, and this is really no problem to do. So this gives you a lot of flexibility, but this also gives you a lot of potential to make code that's difficult to reason about. The reason why this works, again, it's not this function, but so again, thinking like about the object and the variable space. So let's make this. So what happens when you write an expression like a equals a list of, let's say, 1, 2.2, and then h as a string, and closes. So what first happens is that all of those objects are created here. So we get a 1, we get this float, and we get the string. And then finally, a list object is created. So a list object, let's say, like by default, with 3 places here. And instead of directly containing those objects and put them in the memory location where the list lives, the list just has, so to say, references to the objects living in different locations of the memory space. So this is just a reference to this object, this is just a reference to this object, and this is just a reference to this object. And because of that, it's possible to lay out this in memory, because all the references have the same size, and you don't have objects of different sizes that would make it difficult to put the objects side by side in the memory layout. So this is how you can think of having a list. Yeah. So lists are not just very flexible in terms of defining things, but also in accessing the values inside the list. So you do not just want to put them in there and then forget them there, but you want to pull them out at some point again. And for doing this, you have item access on the list. So once you defined your list, you can call again in square brackets and then an integer index and get the value at this position. So this here, we see we defined this list as A, blueberry, strawberry, pineapple, and we get the first and the second entry in that list by using this syntax here. So Python indices start at zero, as they do in most programming languages, and there are reasons for that. It's just something that you're probably already used to, so nothing that should surprise you. What maybe does surprise you is that you can also, you do not just can access the items from the front, but you can also start from the back. So and to get the last item, you can just write minus one, because there is no minus zero, which would be like the, so to say, the last item in correspondence to the first, but so the last item is assigned to minus zero, minus one, and you can also do this to get the list items from the back. So next up is that now you, there's something called slicing in Python. So it's not just possible to get a single object from a list, but it's also supports more complex expression to get like sublists from a collection or like subcollections from a collection. And this is the slicing syntax. And this is basically works as follows. So if we have a list here containing all the numbers from 0 to 9, and then we write 0 colon 2, what will happen is that we get all the items from 0 and 1 and no others. And the reasoning behind is that this syntax can be interpreted as start and stop, and where we have the selection of getting everything that is or starting at start and then getting all the elements that have an index that is bigger or equal to start but smaller to stop, so the last item is exclusive, so you don't get compared here. So B of 2 would be 2, but you don't get this item even though you ended here with a 2, but it ends one index before that. So this is just something that you need to think about, but this also makes it very beautiful if you want to split your list into several lists. So because now I can just write something like 2 to the end, which we would actually do in the next step, and then we would split our list into two sublists, right? So and I can just like put the same number that I have here at the end, here at the start, and I don't forget any kind of element in between. Yeah, so same here. So if you don't specify the end using slicing, it will by default go to the very end of the list and will just take everything. And another thing that you can do is using the slicing syntax is just write a colon, and if you don't have a start and you don't have a stop, it will start from the beginning and go to the end, and it will create a copy of the list. So doing this, we will see that B is not the same as B this, because we will have a different list now. Yeah, and we will get to this later, what the caveat is with copying from these collections. Okay, so finally you can also take everything but not the last item, again using this syntax starting from the back. And finally there's a third element that you can specify in the slicing syntax. So the first two items are start and stop, but the last item will be a step. So you can specify a step function and or no, not function, but yeah, parameter. So and if you have a list like this, and you have 1, 2, 3, and 4, and you start at the beginning, and you have a step of 2, it will only take this and this. And you can also make like variable number of steps, and it will step through this list like using this kind of spacing in between. Okay, so to try this out, the next exercise is to get from the list B, which was here defined at the top, just numbers from 0 to 9, to get all the numbers divisible by 3, just using the slicing syntax. Yeah, so again, we have a few minutes time for you to think about it and try it out, and then someone can tell me the solution. Yes. This one? Okay, so let me see if I can find some space here. Yeah. Okay. So if we have a list like this again, 5 and then 6. So now what we can do is directly behind we do the slicing syntax now. So first, okay, let me assign this to a variable, and then we say here A, and then from just like from 0, which is start, to the end, which is 6, right? And then we say, okay, we want to have a step of 2. So this means that we would take all the list, but only every second entry. So we would take this entry, properly. So what you can also do is, instead of having a step of 2, you can have a step of 3, and then you would have this entry, but only this entry, and then this entry. Okay. And then by default, the step is always 1, so you don't have the stepping. Okay, so who was able to find an expression to get all numbers divisible by 3 from B? Okay, sum, great. Okay, of course we have to get on. I will now show the solution. So we have to do two things. first we have to get only every third number to get all numbers divisible by 3. So we can say, okay, give me everything from start to stop, and then with a step of 3, and we get a list like this. However, 0 is not really divisible by 3. So what we would also like to do is only start at the at number 3 at anyway. So we start by starting only at 3 and then doing a step of 3 going to the end, and this is a solution of how you would do that. Okay, so next, once we have a list, or once we created a list, it's not something fixed, but it's a mutable data type. So there are operations that directly operate on this object and that transform the object without creating a new object. And the most common method for mutating list is calling append. So if we remember b, and b was a list like this, and now we call b.append, and with the string banana, we will have the same list, but the string banana here at the end. However, the object b is still the same. It was just like internally, it was dynamically enlarged, and the object and a new reference to the object banana was put in there. And yeah, as we said, we can put anything into lists, so we can also put other lists there, or we can put other functions inside there, and that's totally possible. Then another method that mutates list is pop, though pop is a little bit difficult because it's a mixture of both manipulating an object and then also returning something. That is something that most of the time that's not so nice, but for example, you can call pop on b, and then you will get this list, and then the last item should be removed from the list, and this would be then in the variable popped. So maybe if we just look at those in separation, we see, okay, the function that was here is no longer there, and in popped now contains this function. So something that's useful if you already have a second list and just want to append all of the values inside the list is, instead of calling append for each item, is calling extend, which will just like combine the two lists. So here we'll have like the elements of that list that we passed here to extend just flattened out and appended individually to that list. So lists also define operators, actually the same as strings. So you can, for now I just like don't do this. So if we have a list like here, and then a second list just containing a single entry, but then we multiply this list, we will get these values n times, the times that we multiplied it with. And we can also concatenate two lists by doing just a plus between them, and this will string the two lists together. So again, lists also define respond to the len function that will give you the length of the list or the number of elements inside this list, but now we have quite a few. And while talking about the slicing stuff, it's also interesting that strings also kind of behave as lists, or they also respond to the same interface by calling the slicing interface. So we can also end a string, say, okay, give me all the values up to the value 5, and you will only get the first 5 values. But internally, it's quite different than a list. So a string is not something where it points to individual characters. So then we have a common gotcha with assigning values to elements of lists. So earlier we talked about the thing that if you assign A to something, or A to 1, and then B to A, and then you change the value of A, the value of B is not does not change. This is only true to a certain extent for lists. So here we have a list like this, then we assign B to A, and then we change the first value of A to cheesecake. So now we want to print B. So If you think of what I told you earlier, then we would expect that B would still be like this. However, that's not true, because B now also contains the value of cheesecake that we put only into A. So how is this possible? So to understand this, we again have to think about how lists are implemented. And I told you before that a list just contains references to objects inside. So now, in our example here, we assigned the value A, or not the value, the variable A, to this list object. And now in the second step, we also assign the variable B to the same list object. And now, so this is basically like doing this, then B equals A, and then in the next step, we now assign, at the index 0, we assign a string in this case. Cheesecake, whoa. What is happening? Anyway, so we assign a value to the first element of A, and now also the value of B changes, because when we do this, what happens internally is that we kind of follow this reference. So we look at, so first again, we create a new object, the string C, because that's on the right-hand side. This is what always what happens first. And then we look here, okay, okay, here the zeros object of A, and this is this reference, and now we assign this reference to C instead of 1. And so, but still the variable B points to the same list, but now inside the list, the references to the object change. So, and this is why when doing something like this, we don't have the same guarantees as if you work with immutable data types, because the data itself is mutable, and then the variables still point to the same data, but the data changed. And this can give you surprises sometimes, so you should be aware of this. So I don't know why this is the case now. Anyway, if you want to avoid this, and there are situations where you want to avoid this, what you can do is use a deep copy. So earlier on, when we used this square brackets and then just a colon syntax, it was a soft copy. So this means basically what we saw earlier, that you would create a second list but containing the same references. Now, if you want to, well, that's actually not true. However, if you have a deep copy, this is avoided. So this would mean that if you call deep copy on A and assign this to B, that you would copy the entire list, including the references inside the list. And by doing this, you can avoid this problem that if you assign then something to A, you don't have the problem that the contents of B also change. However, this comes with a trade-off, because copying means that you need to allocate new space, and this takes time, and you don't want to do this if there's no reason for you to do it. Yeah. Okay, what will this print? this is also interesting here. Okay. Anyway, so another operator that is defined on lists is the in operator. So if you want to check whether an element is part of is part of a list, you can just say element in collection, and this will also evaluate a true or false depending on whether the element is inside the list. Okay, here we have a small exercise. So the question is, what will this return? We don't have the solution is just at the bottom, basically. So you can maybe think 2 minutes about what this will return, and then, or why it returns what it returns. Yeah, so just to solve this, so what is happening here, we create a variable, then we create an empty list, just using this two square brackets here, then we append a value to the first to the first list, then we assign this list to a different variable, then we append to the second list, and then again we want to print these two lists and also the initial variable. So unsurprisingly, the initial variable does not change because it's an atomic type, and if we assign something new, nothing should happen. It means it just takes a new value, but inside these lists they are now equal, even though we just appended the first value to the first names and the second value to this another list of names, but they internally refer to the same object, and we, so to say, call append on the same object, and so we append to the same object twice. Does this make sense? Okay, cool. So then the next type of collection in Python are tuples. So tuples are quite different from lists, or maybe not totally different. Superficially they are very similar, but internally they work very differently. So a tuple is also just a collection of things that has a certain order, but in contrast to lists, you cannot change, or they, in contrast to lists, they are immutable, so you cannot change the object once you created it. So first, to create tuples, you just put commas between things, and then you will see here this as a representation of x, and if we look at the type of x, we will see, okay, it's a tuple. What we often do to make this more explicit, that this actually is a tuple, is that we put parentheses around here. But to make sure, so what turns this literal into a tuple is really just this part here. So the parentheses are just for grouping statements. It does not really create a tuple. So if you just write, what may be surprising then, if you rely on this bracket, so just doing this, it does not create a tuple, it just creates a one, because it just like groups the expression. It just groups the expression of one here, and so we just evaluate this first inside the expression, so nothing happens. However, if you put a comma behind this, we will get a tuple with a single entry. As I said, so tuples are immutable. So here, if we create a second tuple containing the same numbers, and then ask for whether it's the same as original tuple, that's true, because like the tuple, they contain the same objects, all of which are equal. But what you cannot do, you cannot assign to the first element of the tuple, because as we said, they cannot be changed. Once a tuple is created, it always stays the tuple it was at the moment it was created. Similarly, this also does not work, and there's no way to call append or any kind of mutating the object itself on the tuple. So what instead, what you can do if you have a tuple and you want to change what it contains, you need to take all the elements, maybe put them into a list, then append to the list, and then again convert this to a tuple. Okay, then another handy type or handy variant of tuples are so-called named tuples. So tuples are often used if you have like a fixed layout of some data. So for example, you have a color and you have RGB channels, so red, green, blue. So what you can do is just use a tuple with three entries, and then always use element 0, element 1, element 2 to refer to this three colors. However, for someone reading your program, there's initially no way to understand which element you used to refer to the different channels. So it could also be that you use a different color representation, say HSV, and then you don't know whether 0 now means hue or means red. And to avoid this, you can use named tuples. So named tuples let you kind of create custom tuples with fields. So you just say named tuple of the name the named tuple should take, and then the fields it has. And then you can do something like this. You can call color with the elements you want to put inside there. and then you can say yellow.red, but you can also still say yellow at position one, and this will be the same thing and just will be an alias, but it will still be as efficient as a tuple. So because tuples have this property of being immutable and they don't need to internally respond to dynamic resizing, so to getting bigger or smaller over time, they are very efficient. And it often, if you have cases like this, it makes sense to use the name tuple here. Yeah, and you will also get a nice string representation automatically. So then another, so I would say like the really most important collection types in Python are lists and dictionaries. So lists are lists you use very often, also dictionaries you use very often, and dictionaries are also used internally to implement most of the language. But you don't see it. However, so what a dictionary is just a key value map. So you have, instead of just accessing items by a fixed integer index where you have a fixed ordering, you will now have a store where you assign a key, in this case here we have the string, to a certain value. And then later on you can access the values you defined here using the keys you put in there. And so here in this case we define some conversion factors from inches to feet, from inches to meter or so, and then we can access what we put here using the key that we defined here. So the syntax is, instead of square brackets, you have curly brackets, and then for each key value pair you have like the key colon the value and then a comma to the next key value pair. Yeah, and we can also add key value pairs using then again square bracket syntax, so because square brackets always means item access, and we can access this item. If it does not exist, we can assign a new value, and then we see that our dictionary now has a new entry. So it's called dictionary because like it's like in a dictionary, when you want to know the meaning of a word, you start with a word, you look in the dictionary and you get a response. You don't say I want to know about word 55. So internally dictionaries are now ordered as well, but you cannot really make use of that order most of the time. So for now, just you can think of it really as an associative storage where you put in a key and get back the value and don't really have to care about the order inside. So when you want to update a dictionary with a separate dictionary, like the equivalent to extend on list, so you can call update, and then all the new keys and values will be put into this dictionaries. What happens when you try to access a key that is not defined in the dictionary? You will get a key error. So the Python will say, okay, you ask for this key in this dictionary, but it simply does not exist, so I can't do anything. So if you want to check for keys in a dictionary, you can just use in. And if you know that, or if you expect that the key will not be found, you can use, instead of using item access with square brackets, you can use get, and then you can specify a second default value. So here in this case, we know that decimeters in meters is not defined. And now instead of a key error or a key error that is raised, we get the default value that we defined here. So this is also a good point to talk about some programming paradigm that is often used in Python, and this is it's easier ask to forgiveness than look before you leap. So when you think about this example here, we say, okay, what we can do is, if we are not sure that the key is actually inside the dictionary, we can first check that the key is in the dictionary, and then if we know that the key is in the dictionary, then we assign it. So we say, okay, is it in there? Then we print it, else we say, okay, it was not in there. So this is look before you leap. Before you do actually something, you check that all the preconditions are satisfied that actually make your operation possible. The other way is it's easier to ask for forgiveness than permission, where you say, okay, instead of first checking all the preconditions, I just do it, and if something goes wrong, I can still recover from this situation. So in Python, you have the keywords try and accept. So this is, I think in Java, it would be try and catch. So this is just equivalent. So you can do, you do try, and then you do the statement in this block where you expect some error might be raised or some exception might be raised. And then below that, you say accept the kind of exception that I expect to be raised, and then I can still recover from this. So here in this case, we just try to access this key in the dictionary, and if a key error is raised inside here, we accept it and instead print it was not there. So this is kind of equivalent to the to what we do above here. However, it's usually in Python, it's a preferred way of doing things, and one reason for that is that it's often very hard to check all your preconditions. So if you just want to access a key in a dictionary, it's possible, right? You have a possibility for this, but often you have way more complex code that can raise a lot of different errors, and then it's really better just to say, okay, I try to do this, and if something goes wrong, I recover from it instead of painstakingly checking for all preconditions and then still forgetting one, and then the code will blow up in the end anyway. So this was a small interlude on Look Before You Leap. You can also follow this link to get more background on this different approaches to error handling. And then finally about dictionaries, there are keys, values, and items methods that you can use to get all the keys, values, and then the combination of goal keys and values. So okay, this does not show it so nicely. Let's maybe just do it here. So maybe if we look at the dictionary on its own, this is how it looks. So if we now take all the keys and convert this to a list using this explicit list constructor here and print all those, we can see that we get all the keys defined here, and similarly for the values, we get all the values that are defined. And then finally, if we use items, we get tuples of both keys and values. And this is useful if you want to iterate over a dictionary. So say you have a lot of stuff inside a dictionary, and then for each item inside the dictionary, you want to perform some operations, then you can use these three methods to pull out all the values. And yeah, maybe one more, since we're almost finale, so we have 5 minutes, so I think we can do sets because it's not so difficult actually. So sets are, I guess, even the last collection type that we'll talk about in this lecture. So sets are unordered unique collections of things. So they are a bit like dictionaries in the sense that they are not explicitly ordered, and they are a bit of like lists in the sense that you can that you don't have a key value mapping, but you can also not really access things inside a set by item access, because sets don't have order. So sets are really like mathematical sets, right? They don't have an order. You cannot access the items by by index or something. And you can also not have twice the same item inside. So they are like as literals. They are declared by using, also again, curly brackets. What you should be aware of, however, if you want to make an empty set, this is also here below, you cannot use just empty square brackets, because it will default to an empty dictionary. So instead of the literal syntax, you need to call the explicit constructor of a set to get an empty set. And if you do this, you get an empty dict instead. So as I said, sets are unique. So even if you put the same item several times inside a set, in the end, if you look at the set, it will only contain it once. And there are a bunch of operations that are much more efficient on sets than on lists. And that is, for example, checking for membership. So what you can do with a set very easily is that you So here, okay, what we do here, we create a list of numbers from 0 to 10,000, and also a set of the same thing. And now we want to check if the number 900 is in that set, and we time this operation. So and this takes some time, and we also do the same for the list. And because of the implementation of sets, you can very easily check whether something is in there, because they are hashing based. So what happens is, like, the value you ask for, is it in there, will be hashed, and it will be compared to the hash inside the set, and that's very efficient. While for a list, you really have to go through all the elements in the list and ask for each element, are you equal to me? If yes, then I'm in the list, and if not, I go to the next item. So we see that for sets, this only takes 77 nanoseconds, while for lists, it takes a few microseconds. In addition to that, sets support like a lot of some operators that you know from set arithmetic, so union, intersection, difference, and also whether things are subsets. You can ask for that. So when you want to do things like this, and then let's see if we still, okay, we still have 3 minutes, so that's perfect to do with the final exercise here. So the question is how it's possible to make a list unique. So here we have a list of cakes, and now you want to, and you have the value of cheesecake twice in there. And now you want to get rid of this value duplication somehow, and you want to have a new list that, or maybe just the same list that does not contain the value cheesecake twice anymore. So yeah, there's a lecture ends in 2 minutes. You have 2 minutes to do this, and then I will show the solution, and we'll continue on Thursday with control flow, and also the homework will be then only released on Thursday when we are done with the introduction. Yeah, thanks for coming. Any questions left right now? So if you still have problems with installing stuff, you can probably come to us right now and we'll try to help you.